Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Data Factory series, which is now considering the topic of decentralized AI. And my name is Ebba Josefsson Lindqvist, project manager of the Data Factory, and I'm here also Mats Nordlund, board sponsor for the Data Factory. And we are really happy to continue this series of webinars. And today we have the pleasure of having the Swiss Data Science Center presenting their platform, the Data Custodian. And that's from 9 till about 10. We'll do a short stretch of legs. And then at 10 o'clock, we'll start hearing Google's presentation about the work they do on federated learning, showing some use cases. And after each session, we'll also have a Q&A for about 10 to 15 minutes. So feel free to add your questions in the Q&A tab at the bottom. And then we'll go to the questions just after the presentations. And this webinar is being recorded. Just so you all know that. And before we go ahead with the presentations, we have a message from our sponsors, and I will just share the screen again and Mats will say a few words.
Yes, good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to see you all here. I just wanted to draw your attention to some opportunities that we have here in Sweden to get funding for projects that are related to what we will hear about today. It is Vinnova who has several open calls. You can access these at the Vinnova website at vinnova.se, which is at the bottom right corner of this slide. The first one that I'd like to draw your attention to is directly relevant to the presentations today on federated learning. The call is called Decentralized AI Systems, and you can apply for projects in edge AI, federated learning, swarm learning, mesh learning, and so forth. Typically two companies in collaboration at least, and you can apply for about 500,000 SEKs. The next call that is open is called Start Your AI Journey. It has two parts. One is for public actors and the other is for private or business actors. Here you can apply for your first machine learning projects to learn and to evaluate how would AI or machine learning work in your organization or in your business or products. Here you can try experimenting with existing data you may have and collaborating with others like universities or small startups, or if you're a startup, you can try collaborating with a larger company or with a public organization. And it's much the same for the business Start Your AI Journey. And the last one that I'd like to draw your attention to today is called AI in the Service of Climate. And the idea, this is a larger grant, the other two are smaller. This is about 10 times the size. And here you can develop AI for that has come out of research into some kind of tool or to some kind of applications with environmental benefits. So if you have results like that you'd like to bring into reality, take a look at this call. So with that, I'll pass back to Ebba and to the main topics for today.
Thank you, Mats. And as I mentioned, today we have the pleasure of having an international speaker, the Swiss Data Science Center, and we have with us Eric Bouy, who is Chief Architect of Chief Architect Head of Engineering at the Swiss Data Science Center, and you will tell us more about the Data Custodian, which is a platform for sharing data with a secure vault, privacy-preserving compute, and how to go from data ownership to the use of data. Okay, Eric, welcome. And we can't hear you now, so let's see if...
Hello, everybody.
Yes, now we can hear you perfectly.
Yes.
Welcome.
Can I share? So it is my pleasure today to talk about the Swiss Data Custodian and the work we do for privacy. Can I share my screen?
Yes, please. And right. Feel free to go ahead.
Please confirm that you can see my presentation.
Yes, we can see it perfectly.
All right. So let's get started. So the topic of this presentation is going to be about the Swiss Data custodian. So it is a solution, open source solution we are building for providing like a way to do like analytics in a privacy conscious way. Before I present the custodian Swiss Data Custodian platform, I would like to talk a little bit about very briefly present the Swiss Data Science Center. So it is an initiative between ETH Zurich and EPFL in Switzerland. We started in 2017 with two people, and then we have grown to about 50 plus employees in the past 3 years. A good mix between computer scientists, which I lead, and data scientists. And we are working on academic and industrial projects together, taking a pragmatic approach to solve industrial problems with an academic mind. One of our first solutions that we have been building at the center, which is becoming now quite popular in the academia, is the Ranku platform. I'm not going to talk about that today, but you can have a look at what it does. We have a service online, and I put the URL here, rankulab.io. So this said, let me talk about the platform itself, so the Swiss Data Custodian. I will first start with some motivations. So as you know, now like data is at the center of everything. There's a legitimate use need to use data and process sensitive and personal data in order to conduct industrial and scientific research. And this, on the other hand, this data is becoming increasingly regulated. You just need to look at the GDPR and the Privacy Act laws. Not only that, but citizens are also getting like more and more conscious about the need to protect their data, their privacy. Just to give you an example, so like last year when Apple came out with the version iOS 13, they added very simple features that gave like people more control on their data and whether they wanted to share their locations. And within a very short time, within 6 weeks, basically 80% of iPhone users, the location data of iPhone users was lost. So for us, we saw the Swiss Data Custodian a good opportunity to provide the new solutions and the lead like a more privacy-centric form of digitalization. So let me explain that with what I mean by that. So we start first with the current state of affairs. We are like looking actually at a different kind of use cases. So we have we are trying to approach the business to business use case and also the business to B2C, business to consumers use case. And here I'm going to look at the B2C part, like example, taking a citizen perspective. So this is the current state of affairs, right? When you know we are like increasingly connected to the internet. We use the services, banking services. We use a Google Map. We have a Facebook account, LinkedIn account. We access the internet to conduct our like financial activities. It's even our cars are connected. Even when you turn on the TV, no, there's not much you can do without knowing what you're watching. So this is these interactions is creating. Basically, there's the data that you share with the services, but there is also the data that you do not necessarily see, right? Data that, for instance, like cookies or like all the center activities that are like recorded that go somewhere into this dark space in the internet and then gets aggregated to constitute a digital you, right? It is aggregated, so like the data that is generated between different services are correlated, they are enriched by companies that are specialized in this, right? Like, so I'm giving a few examples here, People Data Labs and Oxidata, because they were, they become famous last year for leaking like billions, like data from billions of people, profiles. And what they do is really they constitute a digital you that represent a proxy of yourself on the internet. this digital view is then used, right, when you conduct activities with other companies, like think of, for instance, like insurance, to then make decisions, such as like granting you or denying you like life insurance policies. So do you see that there is a need here to unlock like potentials for a fair data economy, a data-driven scientific research? I mean, the problem with the picture I just showed you is that the data that is collected at the top here, this is data that a user is not necessarily aware of. You can ask for it, right? The laws allow you to ask those different services to get back to this data. But it is very often like people are not aware of like what is being collected about themselves. And even if you can ask for this data, it is very difficult actually to trace it all the way to this digital you, this proxy, right, that is being constructed about you on the internet. So like what we proposed here is a solution that allows you to get back control of this data, right? To give you legitimate control, meaning that this is your data. You should be able to decide what data, who can access this data and what can they access. And also decide on the rights to privacy, right? Whether you want to share this data or not. So the GDPR laws are in place to enforce that. And we want to do it in a more automatic way. It's also, and this is probably the bigger problem I see in this picture, is that there is no transparency. Users typically are not even aware of what is happening on this dark side of the web, right? Personally, I have no problem sharing my data. I just want to know what is happening to it, what the others know about me. So this is like the other aspect is to restore transparency. And then once you restore transparency, then I can trust, right? Restore trust. And finally, the last point here is to also like promote equality for opportunities. So this data is usually kept, right, by those companies like secretly, jealously. It is not easily shared. And it doesn't offer much room for opportunities, right? Like new, like small businesses to come in and like take advantage of this data as well, right? So we want to make it more open and to increase like a chance like for like new like startups to be able to have access to this data and like break like monopolies. And of course, also for the startups, because data is becoming more and more regulated, to ease the burden of regulations, to provide them with solutions that from the start allows like basically standards, like best principles and methods that allow them to be like a GDPR compliant from the start. So the way we want to approach the problem here is the way we're building this Swiss data custodian solution is first to separate data from its use. So instead of having this data going directly to those businesses, to offer you a place, right, or a means to store this data into a vault. It's like a banking system, right? You put your money in the bank and then you decide how you spend it. So of course, like this solution needs to be secure, because if it is not secure, everything else I'm going to talk about after does not really, I mean, if you cannot enforce it, it won't make much sense. And the way we want to do that is to provide like basically open source. So we're building open source solutions that participants, service providers, can install on their servers and then use to offer you like this data storage space. So this data storage, you want also to gain back sovereignty on it. Right? Once you store it, you want to decide who can have access to it. And this is not an access you want to leave to the storage facility here, because you don't necessarily trust them. What you want, you want to encrypt this data, and then you want to keep the keys. And then decide who you give the keys to, right? Outside the storage. So you ship the data out and then you just, or part of it, and then you give the keys at the destination. You want to keep a record of what you share. And one way to do that is to basically all this sharing should happen under the umbrella of a contract, what we call a consent. Consent should be easy to read. They should be clear. They should say exactly, tell you exactly what data you are ready to share, and for how long, like from what time to what time. And they should even like be able to like to show you like a preview of this data, so that you have a better understanding of like what is being exposed, right? What you're giving away. And it should specify the terms of how this data then is being used by others, right? So when you share this data, what is going to be accessed from, who is going to have access to it, what is going to be done with this data, and who else is going to have access to the derived data. So for that, there should be standards, and standards that are then controlled by a neutral entity, like governance layer, to make sure that they are fair, they respect equality for opportunities, that they are not, we don't have one party abusing the other, and also that governance that can enforce the compliance with this consent and compliance with local laws. And also making sure that this data is being used in an ethical way. So like if I go back actually on, so this, so far, like right now you've seen like, okay, I protect my data. I have like a contract under which I can, that is clearly specify the terms under which this data can be accessed. But you see that they still like, you know, we are losing a little bit control of what is happening on the edge. Once the data is here, we can easily copy it, right? So you have to make sure that you only share what is needed. You also, the thing is that you would like to have more transparency. One way to have more transparency is to encourage participating services to join the custodian, right? To set up their own in their own domains and to use like our softwares or libraries so that they are that basically provide the standards method to access this data and to respect the consent automatically and also like to keep a record that they can be used after in terms of like by the governance layers. To ensure compliance and even to penalize, right? In terms of or to arbitrate when there is no compliance. So this is what actually brings privacy, transparency because you have a better view of what is happening to your to this data, to your resources that are being accessed, and also like you can trust it more because it uses like a system that have been proven to enable, like, to encourage this this transparency, to verify this transparency. And finally, there's another like a principle that is very important to us is privacy. So privacy is different from sovereignty. It's not only about deciding who can access your data or not, but it's also to assist you in making those decisions. Right? Like, by that, I mean that, for instance, if I give access to GPS data, I still don't know what I'm exposing myself to. Right? Maybe I'm going to see a specialist, right? For healthcare, and maybe I'm revealing something about myself when I do that I didn't know I was revealing. So this privacy, like you think of it as basically the intelligence of a system that is going to assist you, like helping you decide like what should you share and when you should stop sharing it. So this is actually where we have like the most complex part of this system because it requires some intelligence here, yeah? Is to make those decisions. And this is after where we go into the realm of federated learning, differential privacies, and homomorphic encryptions, those kind of things. So those are the you've seen that here. I'm mentioning like the six principles of our custodian, what we want to enforce here, as we actually forgot to mention. So the privacy is like the another aspect I wanted to say is that also we are looking for solutions. I mean, like basically the solutions need to be decentralized, and this is one way to have a better privacy. So instead of like concentrating the data in a few places, you try to split it a little bit like onion networks, right? Where you don't route the data like through one single pipe, but you can like basically like drive it through different like hop it, so that you cannot track it and or make it more difficult to track, or at least to maintain the privacy. Now, when I say that, we have to be careful. I'm not encouraging like a dark net kind of thing here. Right? It still need to be done under a certain like a governance layer. Or under the supervision of a governance, which is this central, like not central, this like a neutral entity that is sitting on the sideline and making sure that everything is done according to is compliant with the laws. So, thus going back to those principles, yeah. six principles. So those are the ones we are going to use to compare our solutions to basically the state of the art. And also the really the principles that we want to enforce in our Swiss Data Custodian. One final thing I wanted to mention here is that you see that even when you do that, they still have this dark side of the internet here that remains. So one way to make it like a little bit more transparent, like you know, this part that is, you don't control, is to encourage like laws that allow you to track, you know, like for instance, if you go back to the example of insurance here, or it could also even be when you receive an ad that you you think is too customized to your profile, you should be able to automatically ask for the source of information, right? Like the, for instance, like source of information used by the insurance to make their decision, or where did this ad come from? What information they used to basically to make a decision, so like you know which ad is more like relevant to your profile. It's almost like you know you see an ad and you should be able to click on it and so that you could access that information, so that you can track it back not only to the source of information where they got your profile, but also to track it to all the way back to its initial to the source of information, so that you can even detect if there was somewhere non-compliance. Maybe it is at the root of this information, the very source. It was a hospital or like a healthcare facility that leaked some information about you that you were not aware of. So this is what we are trying to build. So now like let's talk a little bit about the challenges. So one, there's an obvious challenge, is a technological challenge. Because here we're talking essentially about enabling non-mutually trusting parties, like owners of data or the people who control this data, to be able to share this data, their data, to combine it in order to extract insight without revealing the content of their respective data. So this is one of the main challenges. But there is also a societal challenge that I haven't talked about, which is the question of trust. Because we want to be able to demonstrate that our solution can and should be trusted with sensitive data, which is probably the biggest challenge here. So you have seen what happened with the COVID situation, right? Even so, we put our best effort to build the solutions that respect the maximum we could to respect the privacy, citizens' privacy. People are still not trusting these solutions. To give you examples, so for instance, in France, I think the contact tracing applications, only 2% of the population is using the application. And in Switzerland, so we will know soon. But it seems that we see more and more people are questioning the privacy aspects of the solution. So this is we need to find like a way, like the, it is not only a technological issue, but it is also how we are going to mediatize the solution. So like we have to be as open as possible, as transparent as possible, and find like the right mechanisms to demonstrate that the solution is indeed can be used to conduct this type of analytics in a privacy conscious way. Now I would like to talk a little bit more about what we are building here. Very briefly, a very high architecture overview of the solution. So what I was illustrating before is a decentralized view of the Swiss data, decentralized solutions. So this is how we want to build the Swiss Data Custodian. Think of it as a secure vault where you can store the data with mechanisms to enable multi-sided computing. Multi-sided, where you have different sites that don't necessarily trust each other. So it must be decentralized. So you'll see those are like decentralized elements, right? Under a neutral governance, something that stands on the sideline and does a check and balance to ensure that everything is done in compliance with laws, right? The local laws. And if you look at this big picture here, so you have on one side, you have the people who are in control of the data, the legitimate, I will call it owners, even though like data is not necessarily something you can own, right? And you have the actors, people who are the basically who have a need for this data, the data consumers. And in between, you have those elements that are responsible for enabling this multi-sided computing, like the places where you can store this data and enable like a processing of this data. And it is decentralized. It consists of what we call individually administered compute and storage domains. So think of it, each of them is independently owned by different participants, like organizations that don't necessarily trust each other and participate in enabling this this process, right? Computations to enable the link between data providers and data consumers. And this should be, in order to enable trust, it should be open and it should be like external, like challengers, like neutral challengers, should be able to audit the process, right? To make sure that it is like the basically respecting like security principles and privacy principles. So how we do that, if we look a little bit in a, like a closer to one of those elements here, what I call the individually administered domains. So they are like a basically like a few functions that they need to provide, and I'm listing them here. So they need, of course, like functions like starting from the bottom here to be able to interact with each other, right? So WebSocket and REST Open APIs, the interfaces. They need to provide the storage, so storage in to be able to store static data, but also events or streaming data, and to provide a CPU or computing resources to be able to analyze this data. On the top, you need to be able to allow users to access those AIDs. To access like individual, so it is multi-tenant, like individuals to access their data, respective data, to manage it. Because it is multi-tenant, or you can have like basically a wide population of users accessing those pods. You should be able to. You need to have like identity management services, so to link a physical entity to like a digital entity in this ecosystem. And you also need to provide them with mechanisms to accept the consents or manage their consents. And then in between, this is like the basically the services that enable this like basically the sharing, exchange of data in a privacy conscious and a secure way. So I'm going to list a few of them here. So there is a compute management, which is responsible when you sign a consent to decide, like you know, basically the applications to keep hidden, right? That need to be deployed to execute the consent, right? To connect the data source to the data consumer, that to deploy it on the compute engine. You need to have, because we are sharing data, as I said, that are encrypted. We need to have systems like mechanisms to share the keys in a secure way. You need to have, of course, an application store where you can audit applications, make sure that they are safe to use. It's a bit like the Apple Store. And you need to have authorities that can audit and certify those applications. Everything that we do has to be, we want to be able to audit in a way that is immutable. So I'm not talking about a blockchain here. It's more like Merkle trees, right? You need to be able to keep this information so that you can use it as a contextual like information so that you can make decisions after. And decisions that are like what we call like dynamic privacy-based access control. So this is where you make decisions whether like data should be shared or not, right? And I call it dynamic privacy-based access control because it will make those decisions based on the current context. How much data like have you already shared with like between different entities? Or even like if you can like share like data like to different like over entities, if you see that this data after is being correlated later on, thus this entity should be able to decide at some point, help you decide, or at least alert you when you're like sharing too much, right? So if everything you see in brown here are basically very simple, I mean, we know how to do them, right? Say they're like components, like the solutions are here. We're integrating them at the point at this moment. The solutions exist. Think of them as the muscles and the bones of our systems. But really, the brain is what you see in the center here, like the system that makes those decisions. And this is where we are like calling for experts. So we have experts at EPFL and ETH Zurich to help us build this entity here. What we call the dynamic privacy-based access control. So this is for the architecture, like a high-level architecture overview. I can answer, if you have questions about that, I can answer them after the presentations here. I'm going to conclude now, so like with a first like a comparative study. So the reason, I mean, why are we building this kind of platform? I mean, why aren't we using existing solutions? So we did, when we started looking at, I wanted to say it came from a need, right? Like actually our partners wanted to have this type of solution because they have sensitive data. I mean, we're working with like hospitals, we're working with industries that want to protect their data. And they wanted to do it in a way where like to enable like this kind of compute in a way that respects like basically without revealing like their data, right? Without sharing their data. So we are looking at solutions before building our own. We did a comparative study of what was out there. And so you see at the top, basically what we found out, right? And like how the existing solutions compared to our needs. So I put them, you know, it's like a kind of average, right? In terms of stars here. And we see that, so like most of them, like they are doing good in terms of security. I mean, we assume this is a given. Not every one of them actually had this concept of consent. I think that the thing that was lacking the most actually was in terms of trust. It was not very transparent, so actually it's kind of correlated. And if you don't, and it didn't have a governance, like neutral, most of them don't have a neutral governance. They govern themselves, right? So we saw that there was a lack of solutions. So we really had to build our own. So here I show you like an example, like just to show that we did some due diligence of what we like the type of solutions we looked at. So at the bottom, this is what we are looking for, the solutions we are building. There are a few of them actually we are looking at closely that are like could have been a good match for our needs. So one of them is a solid from Inrupt, which is actually the solution proposed by Tim Berners-Lee. The inventor of the web. There is the one that everyone should be aware of because it is becoming a standard by a lot of industrial partners, organizations. It is the Industrial Data Space Associations, so it is IDS, and the solution in particular, Gaia-X. And we're working also very closely. They are startup, they are neighbors, and we are looking at complementarities here. So we're working together. It is a PRIV who made their solution open source very recently. So this said, where are we now? What is our strategy and roadmap? So we started working on this in 2019, first quarter. So we had a vision, we had a white paper. In the second quarter, we started our outreach program. So we got in touch with at the federal level. So we had several meetings. We also, of course, being from the universities, so we contacted like professors and experts at ETH Zurich and EPFL. And we also have the full support of our institutional organizations. And then we put together a consortium of industrial partners who are interested in this type of applications. We they contacted us first. They were in public transport entities, so the SBB, this is the train organization in Switzerland, Transport Lausanne, Transport Fribourg. It's not EFL actually, it's not Transport pour Fribourg, TPF. Dynamico is a healthcare application, and we have other partners that I could not mention here. We are in, we contacted so we organizations, one of them is actually personaldata.io, organizations like, who promote data privacy and or ethical use of data. And also we are contacted by journalists, so we are very present in the media and the news in Switzerland. Today we are validating the concept. So we constituted a team end of last year and beginning of this year. It is a very small team at this point. What we want to do is work start first with a minimum viable experiment on a proof of concept with our partnering organizations. So it is actually a health use case, proof of concept that we want to use on our minimum viable experiment to demonstrate the MVE. And the idea here is at the end to refine our requirements. And one of the most important principle we want to test here is the question of trust. What we need to do, what is needed in order to encourage adoption, to ensure that our solution is trusted. And then on the long term, the idea is that toward next year is to implement the full-blown solution with after like end of 2021-22 to encourage adoptions through in particular our Renku application, our Renku platform. So to use it in fact as a backup to our platform. I don't know how much time I have left, but I'm done with the presentation here. I'm ready to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Eric. Perfect. And we do actually have some questions already that come in. So first one here was if the white paper you mentioned, if it's possible to share the link here in the chat, and I'm not sure if you have it easily accessible.
I have it. Can I share it after? Because I would have to get out of my presentation.
Yeah. Please wait till after. But that'd be great. And then possibly we can also share it in an email after or so. But that's a perfect solution for now. And then we also had a question here a bit on the legal side. Being in Switzerland, some people were curious on GDPR, for example, which is a big issue for many companies in Europe. How does that apply to Switzerland, and how are you also relating to GDPR?
So GDPR, so it is a European thing. The thing is that Switzerland is in the middle of Europe, and we are our businesses are very connected to other European entities. And even if we don't have the laws and well as the same laws as the GDPR, we are trying to be as basically as similar as possible. So they are still reworking the Privacy Data Act. But it will be essentially the same as the GDPR. We are respecting the terms of the GDPR. Yeah.
Very good. Thank you very much. And then we did have another question about the IADs. So will the IADs be provided with all the software stack you mentioned, or they should already be equipped with the software stack to join the data custodian?
So yes, so like in fact, I was not very clear about that. So the data custodian, so what we are building here is a software stack. We are not going to provide the services. So the idea is that participants who want to volunteer to join the data Swiss data custodian would like deploy the software stacks on their AID. So they provide the resources, and then they deploy the software stacks that allows them to join the data the Swiss data custodian, and they will service it themselves.
Okay, thank you very much. And then another question here is, what happens in the governance layer? How much of it is automated?
So that's a good question. So like in, if I go back to actually to this slide here, so there are things that can be automated. So like the automation is a big part of it actually is to maintain this immutable record keeping graph. So first, like, and I'm sorry, I'm going to be technical here. We use like a microservice architecture. So everything we do, whenever there's an interactions between any of those blocks, we generate what we call an event, which is says like one block says, I've done this, right? So for instance, I share the key with another block. or I gave authorizations to access the data. So this is kept into this record keeping, which is in fact a knowledge graph. It is a graph that expresses the relations between data, between actors, between computer resources, between and for instance, like this application has used access this data. So this is automatically constructed. This is automatically maintained, right? This record keeping. This is one of the aspects, and it is used then to make decisions, like some of the governance related decisions. For instance, if I will only allow access to a certain set of data, if this data, first, if there's a consent for it, so we verify that the consent was given. So I need to have, in this knowledge representation, I need to have a notion of consent between participating actors, right, who signed this consent. And these applications will run on like hardware resources. Again, I need to keep that relationship. And based on this context, right, those relationships, I can make a decision whether or not to access, to let applications access this data. This is all automatically maintained, right? So it is immutable. And then governance can, after make decisions based, like for instance, like do editing, automatic auditing based on this knowledge representation to see, like for instance, if done, things are being done in compliance with the laws, right? So those are all the automated parts. There are parts that cannot be automated. For instance, like reviewing a consent. When you create let's say a new service, you need to have a consent associated with this service, and the governance entity needs to verify that this consent is fair, right? And that has to be audited by people, right? It is like a manual process. For us, this is actually where we think there will be a bottleneck of in terms of like a governance because it will involve human beings to review, for instance, applications, to review the consents, to review some of those aspects. The idea is to enable like a different level of trust and of trust and like a confidence you can put in the system. If you, for instance, review the data, you think there's not much sensitive information in it, you can allow like basically solutions that maybe are less, don't have the same level of trust, right? So you don't need to audit them as much. But now for like a data that is very sensitive, then you need to spend more time on this auditing process.
Great, thank you very much. And we actually did have a question too. Is the consent a textual contract, and is it verified automatically? And it's basically what you were explaining here a little bit, right?
Yes. So the consent is a machine readable contract. I mean, a human and machine. Basically, it is a human. It is a textual control, but contract. But it is structured. So we need to have standards, right? So that is structured so that it can be machine interpretable, and then automatically used to deploy the, for instance, like to give you an example, right? I have a consent between me, who is the data providers. I accept to share my data between the data consumers who want to do something with the data, between the service providers, right, who is going to be act as the intermediary, right, who is going to process this data between you, the data provider, and the data consumers. Even the consent between also the another actor, the person who provide the resources, compute resources, because there might be like another party. And even also like if the application, the service provider use applications, like from an application developers, it could also have a license agreement. So you've seen that here I'm mentioning, I mean like one, two, three, four entities, right, that sign this consent. This consent, then, once it is signed, it is automatically put in place. It is machine interpretable, and it is sent to the compute management, which decides how to deploy the applications. It has been signed. It has been verified. Right? There is a certificate. So everybody has agreed to that consent. It is so now we can trust it, and it is automatically interpreted and used to execute the actual process. Right. So it is both human and machine interpretable.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. And then we have another question here. Is the differential privacy and other mechanisms implemented with the individually administered domain?
So yes, so and for that we don't have a solution yet. What we have, as I said, we are building the, I mean, we have the muscles and the bones, as I said, right? So the mechanisms that allow you to, for instance, deploy differential privacy applications, but we don't have the applications themselves, and we don't have the mechanisms, yeah, to make the decisions like how to deploy those applications, right? I mean, the way we see, like, for instance, like differential privacy, the way we see like a federated learning, for us, they are like basically pipelines of distributed applications or distributed algorithms that you're going to deploy across the different AIDs, right? And each AID who is going to participate in this pipeline will have its own dynamic privacy-based access control to make sure, like, basically make decisions. Like, for instance, this is a differential privacy pipeline that I'm deploying here, so like to better understand what it does and how it should be deployed. We have the placeholders to do that. We have like basically the shells to enable this logic, but we don't have the logic itself, right? So like and this is where we are actually looking for experts actually to help us with that.
Okay, very good. And the next question is, how does the relationship work between the Swiss data custodian and academic institutions like the ETH, for example?
So we are part of the ETH. We are part of EPFL. We are employees. So we are not for... basically, I mean, we are funded by the ETH and EPFL, sorry, by the ETH domains. So we work on one side with academics who have like basically academics that are customers or like users of this Swiss data custodian. They have I'm thinking, for instance, the academics in life science. We are working with health organizations, right? They need to protect their data. So they are more working on the domains, right, and applications. We also have academics who help us build these solutions. So they are like the experts in cryptology, experts in differential privacy. In fact, we are working with the academics who built here at TPFL the P3DT, which is the contact tracing applications, solution proposed by EPFL. And we're also working with the industry. So industry, where we put in place, basically, we close the gap between the academia and the industry. So we are like, the SDSC consists of employees that with industrial experience and also academic experience. So we have a knowledge, in fact, of both worlds. And we bridge the gap between academia and industry. We facilitate the transfer of academic solutions built for coming from the academic research, and put it with a very pragmatic mind. We put it into practice into the industry, and of course we are not for profit. I mean, we charge the industry for our times or our spent working with them, but we are not making any profit on that. If that answers the questions, right? I mean, like, because the question of relationship actually can be very broad. Sorry.
Yes, that's true. And we can actually move on to the other question that kind of touches on the subject as well. How about the business model and scalability, multi-sided platform network effects, etc.?
So, so for that, what we provide against are the mechanisms that enable the business model, but we are not promoting a particular business model. For us, is that... we are building a solution that will allow you any business model. Because remember, we are doing the record keeping here, that is keeping track of everything that is happening into an AID. And then you can use it. It is a source of information after, if you want to, for instance, to do like a pricing, to decide like, because I mean, basically the business model, it depends, I mean, like what you have is you have resources here. Data resource, compute resource, software resource, service resource, right? That you want to maybe in your business model, you want to put a price on it. How much this is, like, you know, how much you want to charge for them. And the participant can decide, you know, on the price or negotiate the cost. What we do is only provide the mechanisms that allow you to keep track of how much resource each participant use from each other. And after, you can put a layer on top of that. that allows you to then to decide, you know, of the pricing, right? After the once the deal is done, when you concluded the contract, how much you want to charge for that, right? The different participants want to charge for it. But this is not, we haven't promoted a business model. We just provide the mechanisms that allow you to execute your business model.
Very good, thank you. And then we have two questions on basically this very, very similar subject. So is the Swiss data custodian only maintained by the Swiss Data Science Center, or can parts of the system code be open sourced? And Frederick was one of those who asked a similar question, and then we had an anonymous.
It is open source Apache license. What we want is what we do, as I said, we are like funded by public money. Everything we do, we want to return it to the community, and so that they can use it as they want. At the beginning, especially at the beginning, we want to keep some control on the source itself. So we welcome contributions, but we still need to make sure that we build a consistent solution. But ideally, after our intention is to build a community around the source, a little bit what we are doing with Renku. So you can, if you want to see basically, we have a Renku is becoming very mature now. It is a good example of like the way we proceed actually. So you can see like the Renku around the Renku community, what is happening. If you want to have an answer to the question, I guess it will give like a better answers actually. But the idea is to, as the community develop around it, is to even like release some of the control and build a separate entity around the solution itself, with an actor like is responsible for managing the software, making decisions around the software. But it has to remain open source.
Yep, thank you very much. And then we had two questions on trust in relation to this. What is Swiss Data Science Center doing to develop trust among data providers and data consumers that other similar solutions did not provide?
So for us, the trust, it has to be, we are trying to put a focus on transparency. So I didn't spend too much time on explaining what that means, but for us, transparency is, how do we do to ensure that when you show transparency, basically transparency is you have to be as transparent as possible, right, to the users of your solution. Transparency also, they have to be able to trust this transparency. So you have to make sure that the information is complete, right? So that you're not hiding anything, and that it is accurate, that you're not lying of what you're saying about the solution. And so one way to do that is a technological way. So first, depending on the method, for instance, if you use like a key, for instance, a key exchange mechanisms, if you know that the person the person is sure that okay, I have the key. I know who I share the key with. I know what those people I share the key with have access to. That's already, you know, you're in control, right? That's one way, but it's not enough. After, you need to have there's still like a things that people cannot verify for themselves. So another way is to involve external neutral challengers that can audit the solution, that can make sure that the solution does what it is supposed to do. Then of course there's a trust of the external neutral challengers. It is a different question. This is the part, as I said, this is our biggest challenge, right? How to, and we are going to learn as we develop the MVP and the minimum viable product or experiment. This is actually the reason why we want to first start with an MVP is to learn about, what are the best mechanisms we can put in place to maximize trust. To tell you the truth, we don't have the full answer to that yet, right? It is by trying to be as open as possible, but we'll see. We saw what happened with the contact tracing applications. People still don't trust it. And now the question is trying to understand why. But.
Thank you very much. And we'll do one more question before we start wrapping this part of the webinar up. And that's a question from Trent. From a user perspective, how do you deal with usage of data that has been abstracted or depersonalized and perhaps can no longer therefore be individually identified by the data consumer, but was originally calculated upon a record that was acquired without correct consent?
Oh, without correct consent. So I'm trying to understand the question here. So like what it means that I'm having data. I mean, for that, I would need to know. I mean, first, am I aware if whether these data is, should be like the question is that, I mean, how much awareness I have on these data. I mean, like maybe I'm not sure if I understand the question. So like, please correct me if I answer it. That's not the right answer. So first, as we keep immutable record keeping, the point is also to be able to trace the origin of the data, right? When I was showing you in my slides, basically bringing, a participant, right, into the custodian, this is one way to allow like the traceability of the data. You know that this data, where it is coming from, and you can make sure that at every point, like in this lineage, or in this provenance, actually, because that's where it's coming from, you can make sure that there was a consent associated with it. So for that, the idea of the governance is that it is verifiable, right? So at least you have some idea when you get a piece of data that has been derived, like whether it was like a data that has it is derived lawfully, right? You cannot tell on the other hand what happened to that data before it entered the custodian, right? What happened outside the custodian? This is something that is outside our realm, right? There's no way to, you can only make a guess. So the idea of the Swiss data custodian is only to enable the governance on what happens inside the custodian. So this is why the idea is that, I mean, you have to encourage like, you know, participants to join. Or maybe this data, if you don't know where it is coming from, then it is to tag it. So this is in the metadata. To say this is data, I can only put that much of trust on that data, right? In terms of like legality of the data, in terms even in terms of quality, like how accurate it is. But once it is in the custodian, then this immutable record keeping, the idea is that you can always trace it and you can always tie it to consent.
Thank you very much, Eric. That was really, really good. And thank you for also taking the time to do this Q&A. That's very valuable. We take a really short break now, just for filling up the coffee cups and stretching some legs, perhaps.